Welcome to CSET Biology TCP from TCP Academy. I am Mr. Wilson, and today I'll be covering pollination, as it were, for the biology kids. Let's hop right into the lesson. The objectives of today is to define pollination, state the importance of pollination, identify types of pollination, explain the types of pollination, identify agents of pollination, explain the concept agents of pollination, identify flowers, type, and agent responsible for pollination. Then we have for eight, we want to compare and contrast flower pollinated by wind versus those pollinated by insects. Now, what is pollination is probably the first question that comes to mind. Can you tell me, boys and girls, what's pollination? Pollination is a transfer of pollen or pollen grain from the anther to the stigma. You would recall that the anther here is the male reproductive part of the plant, while the stigma is a part of a female reproductive part of a plant. There we have it, the pistil, for which the stigma is also a part. The stigma would fall right to the top. I hope you're looking at the screen right here. This is where you would find the stigma. And we just took this from the flower to your left. Then here we have the stamen, for which the anther would also be a part. This here is the anther. Let us look at what's going to happen now. Now, can you identify the anther and the stigma? We did that already. Now, if you pay close attention to the screen, you're seeing the process of pollination taking place. Can you say what's pollination? Of course we can. Pollination is, of course, a transfer of pollen grains from the anther to the stigma. Here we are seeing these yellow grains being transferred, pollen from the anther to the stigma. Nice animation. Why is pollination important? Pollination is important for the process of sexual reproduction in plants. Now, in sexual reproduction, that's where we'll find the male and female gamete coming together to produce an offspring. But the process all started with pollination, and then we would have had fertilization. Now, let's look at this. Plants that do not reproduce sexually, how do they reproduce? Can you tell me, boys and girls? Of course, they reproduce asexually, and that is, of course, using a part of a parent to produce an offspring. Let's look at types of pollination. Can you name the type of pollination in the animation to your left? What's happening there? Oh, wow. Pollen from the same plant is being moved to the stigma of the same plant. Look at what is happening. I wonder what type of pollination this is. Computer, can you help? Self-pollination. But why is it self-pollination? How would you explain the process that causes it to be self-pollination? Wonderful. Pollen grains of the same plant pollinate flower on the same plant. So we are seeing here it's the same plant that everything is happening on. As a result, this is self-pollination. It has to do with the same plant with the same flowers. It doesn't really matter if it is the same species, because we're just dealing with one plant here. Let's look at another type of pollination. Can you name this type of pollination? Now we have pollen grains being moved from one plant to another. So we are seeing that the grains are now passing this imaginary line in nature. So it's moving from this plant to this plant and from this plant to this plant. While, of course, here we're still having self-pollination taking place. But while self-pollination is taking place here, pollen grain is also being moved from this plant to this plant on the right and from this plant on the right to this plant on the left. What type of pollination would we say that is? Of course, it is cross-pollination. It is crossing from one plant to another, and of course, it is of the same species. How would you explain the process? Wonderful. Pollen grains move from flower of one plant to the flower of another plant of the same species, or one might say the same type of plant. So if we're paying keen attention here, it's pretty much the same type of plant, but it's as if one plant is moving the pollen grain from point X to point B, where there is another plant. Let's move right along. Agents of pollination. What is meant by the term agent of pollination? Great. Agents of pollination refers to anything that moves a pollen grain from the anther to a stigma. They include animals, water, and of course wind. Now, our animals could include our favorite, the honeybee. Identify the agent of pollination in the picture. Can you say what insect that is? It's also an animal. Of course it is the honeybee. Are you observing that pulsing circle? Wow, that is what we refer to as the pollen sac. And in the pollen sac there, we have pollen grain. Wonderful. So we are seeing the pollen sac and of course the pollen grain. Now, why are the agents of pollination important? Wonderful. Agents of pollination are important because they move pollen grains which cannot move by themselves. Why do the bees visit the flower? Of course, the bee would be visiting the flower for nectar to make its honey, and pollen for protein. And there you'd see pollen on the sac, and you can also see the body of the bee all covered with the yellow pollen that is going to clean and of course stuff in the pollen sac. So of course there for pollen and nectar. Types of agent. Now we have two flower on the screen, flower A and flower B. Now pollinating agent will depend on the structure of a flower. Now we are looking at the flower here. Identify the type of pollination in both diagrams. So if you observe here, this flower looks pretty much like a funnel, or one might say it has a fluorescence. While here, we're seeing the anther all hang on the outside of a flower and this feathery stigma here. Now, this is most likely to be found in our Gramineaceae, or the grass family, rice, corn, wheat, cane, bamboo, that type of a thing. While this here would find pretty much in a lot of our dicots. So we have ackee, mango, buttercup, that type of thing, where all these structures are all stuffed on the inside of this fluorescence. Now, can you identify the pollinating agent? Let's try. Great. Insect pollination, because the insect would be getting in to this tube-like structure to collect the nectar and, of course, the pollen. And as such, it could be pollinated by insects, hummingbird, or some other thing. Then on this side, we have wind pollination. As the anther is on the outside, the stigma is on the outside, and it makes it very, very easy for the pollen grains to move and get onto the stigma. Wonderful. Now it's time for us to compare. We want to look at the differences between wind and insect pollinated flowers. First, we're going to be looking at the features of a flower. Then we're going to be looking at wind versus insect. So let us look at the petal. Now, the petal for the wind pollinated flower is usually small, dull in color, not easily seen. One might say inconspicuous. While for insect, the petal is usually large and brightly colored. What about the orientation of a flower, insect pollinated? The flower is usually directed upward, right? So here, for the wind, the flower usually hang down, and of course, the parts, the relevant parts, are usually hanging on the outside, while for the insect pollinator, the flower is usually directed upward with the structure on the inside. Let's look at the location of the anther and the stigma, which we barely touched just now. So for insect pollinated, the stigma and the anther are usually on the inside, of course, in a funnel or tube-like structure. What is it like for the wind? The stigma and anther, they hang on the outside of a flower. Can you recall? Wonderful. The picture we looked at just before we started. Now, stigma, you can see in the picture above, it's somewhat feathery and catches the pollen in the air. What is it like for insect pollinated? The stigma is more rigid, smooth, but sticky. And of course, it's usually on the inside. Pollen grains here for wind pollinated plants, they are usually small and smooth. For insect, they are usually large, rough, and they have a sticky surface. So of course, they can stick to the organism very, very easily. Then the amount of pollen grain produced for wind is usually large, of course, because it's going to be blowing all over the place. It's a little less efficient. However, for insect pollinated, the amount produced is usually small, a little more efficient process. For nectar and the scent, for wind, it's usually odorless and has no nectar. However, in insect pollinated plants, they tend to be sweet scented, and of course, they have some nectar, that which the hummingbird and of course, say, bee and probably ant, they would be in search of. Our next lesson is going to be fertilization. You want to ensure that you join us. Remember to like, share, and of course subscribe. In order to subscribe, what you need to do is to click the yellow icon you're seeing to the right bottom of the screen, or the red button below the video that says subscribe, and click on that bell beside that button. And if you want to find our other publication, the blue icon to your left of the screen that says CSEC Biology TCP, click on that icon and it will take you to our many other videos. Thanks much for watching.